You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at Twitter.com/options, StockTwits.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or via questions at TheOptionsInsider.com. And now, it's time for the show that breaks down the options market from unusual activity alerts to market analysis, strategy overviews, listener questions, and much more. If it involves puts and calls, then our all-star panel will break it down. It's time to hit the Option Block with your host, Mark Longo from the Options Insider Media Group, and co-hosts Uncle Mike Tusaw from St. Charles Wealth Management, along with Mark the Greasy Meatball Sebastian and Andrew the Rock Lobster Joe Venazzi from OptionPit.com. And now, get ready to hit the Option Block.
All right, everybody. That music means it is time once again to commence our broadcast week here on the Options Insider Radio Network. Another great week, a slew, a smorgasbord, a veritable plethora of content coming your way. Usually a couple of shows a day. We got our great pro Q&A coming up tomorrow. We're going to do a double dose of boot camp for you on Tuesday, I do believe. I think this well. So we got to have mixing things up. Education Wednesday, moving all over the place. You know, Dan's schedule, it's crazy. So just getting everything in there because he's going to be traveling again, I think, next week. So accommodating everyone's travel schedule. Speaking of travel schedules, well, before I get to that, we'll get to that in a second. My name, of course, is Mark Longo from TheOptionsInsider.com, as well as, of course, from the ever-scintillating network upon which so many of you are binging these days. Glad to see so many of you are enjoying all the content we have coming at you. If you want more in your lives, we got you covered there as well. We got a couple of extra shows for you, including our pro Q&A coming up tomorrow. We got Mr. Scott Nations back in the hot seat. He was just in a little while ago. He loves it so much. He's back again. He really likes you folks in the secret club. So if you want to join that, of course, get access to Options Oddities every Friday, get our giveaways throughout the week, and a whole bunch more. You know where to go. TheOptionsInsider.com/pro or indeed /secret club for all of you cool kids out there. Let's see what cool kids are joining me on the show today. Well, actually, before I even get to that, I'm getting ahead of myself today. We have to commence our broadcast week the way we always do, listeners. You know, we've been doing this for a little bit now, naming those 80s wrestlers, guessing those 80s wrestlers based upon, of course, their legendary theme music. 80s, of course, were the highlight, the heyday of pro wrestling. And the theme music was on another level back then. They don't really do it to this degree, even today, anymore the way they did it back then. It was just super hardcore. Everybody had to have an epic theme. And we were trying to figure out who we're going to do this week. We looked at some of the ones we've already done in the past. We've done quite a few, obviously. And one of our producers suggested this one. And I was like, you know what? This team, I think we may have done them before, but I can't say for sure. If it has, it's been quite a while. So it's a good time to resurrect them. And it's an interesting one. They represent an interesting dichotomy from that era, too. One of them reached the highest of highs in the wrestling world. Some people to this day think he was the greatest, and indeed is the greatest pro wrestler of all time out there in terms of skill in the ring and everything else. And the other guy, let's just say he did not. He's one of those, where are they now kind of guys? And when you ask that, and when you look them up, you see horrible stuff. So it couldn't be more of a tale of polar opposites. One got pushed to the moon, and one kind of fell by the wayside. And so, but for a brief shining moment in the 80s, they were a tag team And they came out to this music. Can you guess them? I think you got a representative sample of it there. Now let's go out to the quiet, the sleepy, the tranquil hinterlands of Maine, where we are joined by the uncleest of Mikes, Mr. Uncle Mike Tusaw from St. Charles Wealth Management. Uncle Mike, hey, welcome back to the program. Allow me to say, by the way, it's the first time joining you since you held down the big hosting chair in my absence last Thursday. Let me doff my cap if I were wearing one to you, sir. You did an admirable job in the hosting chair, sir.
Thank you very much. It's not easy.
I'm glad to see you appreciate the effort that goes into hosting all these many and varied programs here on the network, sir. So that said, praise firmly established. Can you guess this 80s tag team, sir? One shot to the moon, one fell deep down into the earth.
Well, real quick, I'm actually broadcasting from St. Charles today, not from Maine. Just want to clarify that.
Oh, did I say Maine?
Yes.
It's because he's beaming into our chat. That's why. That's why he's distracted.
That could be it. He's messing with you. It's hard hosting, folks. I can tell you from experience, but I'm going to go with the Rockers, Shawn Michaels and Marty Jannetty.
Well done, sir. Yes, Shawn Michaels and Marty Jannetty. And one of those guys is like, who? Shawn Michaels, of course, reached the apex of the game. Some people still argue who are wrestling aficionados. He is the greatest to ever do it, to ever lace up the boots. I don't know if I go that far, but he's pretty good. And the other, of course, I think if you look him up now, he's like an internet meme. I think he may have murdered someone. So just it couldn't be more of a contrast of opposites. Have you ever, in recent history, Mr. Uncle Mike, researched what happened to Marty Jannetty?
I have not. I remember he had a brief run in the WCW in the late 90s. And by brief, I think I saw him one time and thinking, oh, yeah, that was Shawn Michaels, his old partner with the Rockers. But aside from that, haven't heard much from Mr. Marty Jannetty.
Yeah, I probably don't go bother researching him. Nothing good comes from it. Just a lot of bad stuff. Speaking of nothing good coming of it, I feel bad because the rockingest of lobsters, the person who I mentioned is distracting me in our chat right now, is actually in Chicago right now as we speak. I haven't seen him in person in a couple of years either, obviously, since all of the lockdown madness happened and he shut the gates on his fortress-like campus there on the shores of Maine. And so he is in town and he was bugging me. He said, oh, can I come in and do the show on Monday? And alas, listeners, because we like you folks so much and we have been endeavoring to load up so much stuff in the studio here to give away to you, our pro members. I don't even have seats in here anymore for our guests. So I need to rejigger and revamp the studio here to set up them. The guest mics have been dismantled to make more room for other things here. So yes, we need to set up all that guest functionality that used to be a regular occurrence here in the studio. So alas, the Rock Lobster is somewhere nearby, but he cannot come on live on the program and his technology is preventing him from beaming in. So we are unfortunately not joined by either of the pit crew, even though I do believe they are in or about the Chicago hinterlands as we speak. We'll probably hear from them later on in the week on the network, maybe live. They're threatening to do Volviews live from their event. I think it's at the Drake on Friday. So we shall see if we make all that happen. Meanwhile, though, it is time to make this show happen. It is time for the Trading Block.
It's time to break down the latest topics, trades, and trends in the world of options. It's time for the Trading Block.
All right, everybody. Welcome to the Trading Block, the portion of the show where we break down what the heck is trading. What is lighting up our screens out there today, listeners. And, you know, it's another one of those weird ones where the market can't really decide what it wants to be today. Is it a down day? Is it an up day? They've done a lot of bouncing so far already today. How many times has the S&P crossed the 4,000 level? Crossed it to 3987 on the dark side this morning. Then it rallied all the way up to a little over 4,020. And then right back down to 3,993, then back up to about 4,024 again, right back down to 4,000 again, then bounce right back up. We're back up around the 4,020 level again. So we'll see if we can hold it or if we're going to just go plunging or rallying in one direction or the other. It seems like we got some rubber band action pulling us in one direction or the other. We shall see which way we end up today. That means it was starting off to be a red day. Now it's kind of mixed. The Dow actually green on the day right now, about a third of a percent. The S&P still off, but only off slightly, about a tenth of a percent. And the NASDAQ, let's see, how low did the NASDAQ get today? NASDAQ got down to 11,642 in the second sell-off before rallying, and the high of the day was 11,789. So quite the range already on the NASDAQ today. It's off about eight-tenths of a percent right now. That means all of our vol friends, they're down from our last show, but not down quite as much as they were, perhaps. Earlier in the sessions here, we have a VIX cash when we commenced operations here was at about 28 and a quarter. So that puts it down almost five, a little over five, actually about 5.15 points from where it was this time on our last show. Remember, things were pretty frothy towards the end of the last week. That's because I wasn't here. Markets tend to get out of control. Whenever I leave this studio, listeners, crazy things happen. So I need to be chained to this desk at all times. A VVIX at about a 110. That's down over 14 and a quarter points from where it was on Thursday's show. A VXX is at about 24.60. That puts it down about 2.6 handles from where it was on Thursday. UVXY, almost 15.5, about a 15.40. That puts it down a little over 3, about 3.1 points from where it was on Thursday. Getting a bit of a theme now, listeners. SVIX, so the inverse VIX product, 10.90. That's up about 1.1 points from where it was on Monday's show. UVIX, the levered 2X VIX product, was at about a 19 even. That puts it down over 5, about 5.5 points from where it was on Monday. And VolQ, the ever effervescent at the money vol of the NASDAQ, at about a 40, a little over 40.5, about 40.60 when we kicked off the show. That's up about 3.3 points from where it was on Monday's show. Remember, if you got questions about VolQ or anything vol related, Scott Nation's joining us tomorrow in the pro Q&A. So start getting those in. All right, Mr. Uncle Mike, the table has been set, sir. I have now released you from your hosting duties. You don't have to talk all the time. Just today, you have to talk most of the time. What is lighting up your tape today, sir?
Put me to work, by gosh. Well, the first thing lighting up my tape is that we have, since the show started and we played the Shawn Michaels, Marty Jannetty song, we have like a 15-point rally in the S&P. So I think you need to just put that on repeat.
The world loves the rockers. What can I say?
I think you just need to put that on repeat, and then the S&P will be at 6,000 by tomorrow. So it's on you, Mark. What are you going to do about that? But anyway, looking at the markets today, I think that it's still kind of recovering from last week, and that we were kind of all over the place last week. And so far, that's continued to hold true in the range with which we've had. We've gotten lows for the S&P in the I believe 39.83. We've had highs 40.27. So we've had a pretty big range throughout the day today, and we are definitely getting some movement in this market. It's interesting that the VIX is actually lower on the day, considering we've had all this movement. But it could also be the weekend effect that Mark and Andrew talk about a lot as well. So we have that going on. We have a little bit of a rally going on in silver. SLV, we're not quite above the 20 mark as of yet, but it's definitely making a run at it right now. And then just a couple other things of note. We have XLE. That's up $2.65 on the day. So that's really taken off, that's for sure. Not surprising, considering the fact that we do have a $3 bump in oil. So a lot of things happening today. We're getting a rally in the 10-year note again. We had a little bit of a pullback yesterday. And so when we have the rally like we have in the 10-year note, Andrew and I were talking last week on the show how we're getting a little bit of an inverse relationship of the markets and the 10-year note. But now it just looks like it's rallying when the market is down slightly. So a lot of things going on. And Let me just take a look at that crypto thing just to see what's happening on it. It's down 2%. So Bitcoin is also down as well. So a lot of things happening right now, and it'll be an interesting week this week yet again.
Come on, you can tell me truthfully. So you were celebrating when you heard all that drama with crypto last week, with stable coins and Tether and all that madness, and Bitcoin dipping back below 30,000. Were you ringing your little bell in the St. Charles office or in celebration?
No, but I have actually looked up some other websites. Just you kind of piqued my interest. I looked up, BitcoinSucks.com. That's kind of pricey. So I looked up BitcoinReallySucks.com. I think that you can get that for like $15 or something like that. So I thought about it, but I decided not to do it.
Buy it. Just have it redirect to StCharlesWealth.com for now. And, you can always build it out at your leisure down the road, sir. I'm sure there'll be a few people who might agree with you right now, given the price action we've seen out there over the past week in particular. If you want to get more insight into that, listeners, we, of course, have the crypto rundown coming up a little bit later. All you pro folks, I should say, we'll get it live in your ear holes. Another great special guest joining us. Maybe we have a chance to break down all the madness that is going on. It was a lot going on. It was a lot of discussion of it at the conference last week because it was all breaking, of course, all this Citadel accusations with Luna and everything else going on out there. So we'll see. Maybe we'll have a chance to get to that on the crypto rundown. By the way, we will break down the volatility, the unusual activity, all that good stuff, and a whole bunch more coming up a little bit later today. Right now, we got to go back down to the markets to see what's lighting it up out there today. And again, a bit of a weird one when looking at the most actives and also the indices, because in general, most of the indices have been on a tier from a volume perspective of late. The VIX is doing all right, but it is kind of the laggard of the bunch compared to certainly the big S&P indices. The VIX right now doing about 275,000 contracts. Again, that's decent, but it's not blowing the doors off out there. You're looking at where we are from an ADV perspective, that's pretty much about exactly half of the ADV. We're a little bit north of 540,000 contracts out there. So the ADV has ticked back north of the 500,000 level. It was languishing far below that for a while. So VIX volume trending in the right direction. We'll see if they can hit that level today. You know what has been blowing the doors off, though, for a while now is the S. You know, S&P could be SPY, could be SPX, whatever your flavor is out there. S&P indices doing some numbers, and that is the case again today. The ADV in SPY right now is 7 million contracts, 7 million even, not 7.01, 7 million exactly. That's a huge number. I would argue that's probably unsustainable over the long term, 7 million contracts a day. But today they're going to hit it. We're already at 3.51 million contracts right now. So already pretty much exactly half of that number on the tape. That's a lot of paper out there in SPY. But again, we're whipping all over the place. So it does make a certain amount of sense. The S, also, the ADV out there ticking up again, it is exactly 2 million. So we have exactly 7.0 million ADV in SPY and exactly 2.0 million ADV in the S. That's a rare occurrence in and of itself, listeners. It's also a lot of paper for the SPX. Again, I would probably argue that unsustainable over the long term. Come see me again in July and August if we're still putting up numbers like that. Probably not out there. But SPX, 1.12 million contracts on the tape today, listeners. So things are rocking and rolling out there in SPX. Let's see if small caps are following suit. And they're kind of lagging behind a little bit today, even though their ADV has ticked back up again as well. It's up to 872,000 contracts. That's a pretty robust amount of paper for IWM. As right now, it's at about 329,000 contracts out there. So intriguing stuff afoot since we have good old Mr. Scott Nations joining us tomorrow. He is a NASDAQ vol guy. Let's look at the Qs as well today, add them to our mix. The ADV in the Qs right now is north of S, but obviously nowhere near SPY. It's at about 3.02. A lot of even numbers in the ADVs right now, which is interesting. 3.02 million, so just a tick north of 3 million in the ADV land for the Qs. And they're at almost half of that right now as well, 1.48 million. So it's a pretty rock'em sock'em robots day out there in the major indices. Let's see if the single names can keep up the pace. And the answer is pretty much no. It only cost you 160,000 contracts to break into the top 10 today. That's pretty much a quiet Tuesday in August kind of volume level. That's kind of what we see when the indexes are rocking. usually the single names don't tend to keep pace and vice versa. So today we're back in kind of a more macro heavy, index heavy kind of mode, listeners. There are some single names obviously doing some numbers, but nowhere near. Let's see, you have to go all the way up to about number four before we see a level that I would consider to be the break-in level for the top 10 on a pretty active day. So again, not the most rock'em sock'em robots of days. Today, at number 10 gets you to Occidental Petroleum. Uncle Mike talking about how oil moving a wee bit today. Oxy following suit. 68.32 right now, up about 4.25 today. So nice little pop out there for Oxy. Still only doing 160,000 contracts today, but that's enough for number 10 on a pretty weak chart today. Number 9 is good old Softy, listeners. They've been kind of popping up a lot here on our top 10. Again, not a lot of volume, only 162,000 contracts. They're up nearly a buck or about a third of a percent. They're trading right around 262. And let's see, how low did Microsoft get in all this, Matt? 255. So they're only $7 off their low for the last month out there. If you go a little bit farther out, it says the one-year low for them is 238. Well, that was pretty much exactly a year ago. That's where they were trading a year ago. So extend beyond that one-year ago period, and their low is pretty much what we just hit a few weeks back. 255 was their low. We'll see if they can hit that again. Right now, 262 and change, getting a nice little lift. Number 8 is NIO. This has been a frequent offender for a while out here, listeners. Of course, Chinese electric vehicles, 200,000 contracts exactly for number 8, which is NIO, trading 1468, up about a third of a point or about 2.5% today. Number 7, it's the much maligned, much beaten up Facebook, trading 238,000 contracts today. What is good old Meta Platforms Inc. up to today? It's up 4.25, about a little over 2, about 2.1%, trading almost 203, about 202.91. See how low did they get? What was their limbo bar in the sell-off? 174.95. That was a wee bit ago. That was on April 27th. So they recently didn't they only got down to 188.75 on the sell-off last week. So their nadir came about a month ago out there, which is kind of interesting. So Facebook having a little bit of recovery over the better part of the last month. Well, let's go out here to number 6, everyone's favorite gold miner slash movie theater chain. It's AMC, 244,000 contracts. They're actually selling off a little bit today, off about 16 cents or about a little over about 1.3%. They're down to 11.65 right now. Let's see, what is the tail of the tape for them over the pad? They hit 10.37 last week, last Wednesday to be precise. That was their kind of near-term low out there. They have, I do believe, earnings coming up here. So intriguing stuff here in AMC. I know the apes are still out there slinging away, good for 244,000 contracts. Number 5, it's a day that ends in Y, so you got to have the chip stocks hanging out around 5 and 4, and that's pretty much what we got again today. Good old NVIDIA, 325,000 contracts. You got to get all the way to number 5, listeners, before you even break 300K, which, again, saying what kind of day we were up to out here today. NVIDIA off about 2.25 or about 1.3%, trading a little bit shy of 175, but about 174.75. It's like their low was 161.75. That was back on the 12th last week. Beyond, that's on the last 6 months. If you go beyond, let's go all the way back to the last year. And their low was a year ago, obviously. So again, this kind of gets back to that theme where we've kind of erased a lot of 2021, and a lot of these names are pretty much trading. Not quite there for NVIDIA. It's got to go down a wee bit more, but it's getting along those lines. Certainly a far cry below their high of 346.5. which they hit back in last November. Number 4, it's Twitter. You know, on again, off again, romance here with Musk. Where else have you seen a deal where they announce it, board approves it, and then he's like, maybe I'm going to do my due diligence now. Maybe you do that before you announce the buyout, but not with Musk. Everything's backwards. 37.63 right now. Man, I feel for that listener who wrote in saying they had that July 50 double vertical. Let us know what you did with that. This is a lot of downside here, unfortunately, for that spread for you holders out there who were thinking it was a done deal, that it was heading to 54.20, I believe, was the price. Doesn't seem like they're going to be going. If it does go through, that is going to go through at that price anymore, unfortunately, for all of you out there. So, yeah, rough day out there, off 7.5% just out there for Twitter, doing 359,000 contracts. Number 3, it's AMD. Again, back to the chip stocks. They're kind of like a broken record at this point. It's somewhere between 3 and 5, you're going to see NVIDIA and AMD pretty much any given day And that is the case. Number three today, AMD, 426,000 contracts. AMD up nearly 1%, or about 90 cents, trading around right around $96 right now. Let's see. Over the last month, it got down to $84.91. That was on April 27th as well. Last week, it got down to only $86.36, so about 10 bucks north of its low from last week. Let's look back on the last year. This is another one where they're not quite giving up the year, but it's a lot closer. It was $74.65 a year ago, and then it rallied to $164.50 in November. So obviously, 96 bucks right now. Much closer to the 74 level than to the 164.50 level. Number two, it's Musk's other favorite team name. It is Twitter. Twitter. He's going to say. It is Tesla. 752,000 contracts. So decent paper, all things considered. The stock taking a bit of a drubbing today, off 40 handles or 5.25%, trading 729.18 right now. That's they're coming for this one today. Let's look and see. This is actually right around, it got to 728 last Thursday. So we're close to that level again, listeners out there, the sell-off from last week. If you go back over the past year, a year ago it was trading 576. So it's got a ways to go to get there, but certainly not on the right trajectory. And then number one, I think a name that some people have been surprised how aggressively they've been coming for this one. This is the fruit company. This is Apple, off another half a buck or about 1/3% out there today. Let's see. They got down as low last week as 142.5, and they're trading 146.5 right now. So they're $4 off the low. Of course, their high for the year, they got up to 182.94. It's like they hit that a couple of times back in January. And then in March again, they got up to 179. So it looks like they threatened it again there. So obviously a ways off that. Of course, you go back a year ago to May of last year, they were trading 126. So they're $20 pretty much exactly above that level. They still have a ways to go, but they have come for Apple over the better part of the last month. It is not immune to the sell-off. And let's see what else. Well, before we get there, let's look really quickly at the earnings. Of course, we had our buddy, Mr. Matt, keeper of all the earnings data on Volatility Views this week. I had a chance to see him in person down in San Antonio last week. That was fun. Just, I can confirm he does live. He does exist. That was fun. Let's see what's fun from an earnings perspective. Got a lot of big box retailers on the docket this week, listeners. They kind of give you a nice broad cross-section of the economy and how things are faring. Tuesday, Walmart and Home Depot. Wednesday, Walmart's nemesis, Target. Well, I guess we could say Amazon's their nemesis as well. One of their nemeses. Lowe's, Bath & Body Works, and Cisco. Thursday, we got Kohl's, BJ's. Man, all the big box stores. And Friday, for all you tractor lovers, John Deere and Foot Locker on Friday as well. Look in here. We're still, looks like we're going to have the updated move results season and everything else coming in shortly. So we're awaiting the freshly updated season and everything else reports. Listen, as soon as those hit, you can find them for yourselves. TheOptionsInsider.com is the place to go. Meanwhile, we got to get on out of here and right on into the odd block.
It's time to break down the most interesting, unusual, and downright questionable options activity that's been identified by TheOptionsInsider.com. It's time for The Odd Block.
All right, everybody, welcome to The Odd Block. Mr. Uncle Mike, usually you get to rest your voice during this section of the show. But today, sir, I will drag you into duty. Are you ready to talk some oddities, sir?
I am ready. Let's get odd. Let's get weird.
All right. Let's get weird. I like when you're all fired up for a little bit. Unusual activity, sir. It gets me fired up. And then the audience is fired. Everyone's fired up. Let's get out there, sir. You were talking energy earlier. I like to deliver in areas that you like, Uncle Mike. Unfortunately, I don't have any control over the Eye of Sauron. It is a very capricious master at the end of the day. But today is delivering. Giving us a newcomer here for our first name out of the block. This is Patterson UTI Energy Inc., ticker symbol PTEN, P-T-E-N. This provides land drilling and pressure pumping, easy for me to say, pressure pumping services for drilling companies in the U.S. and Western Canada. This name trading pretty much $16 exactly right now. Today, they're up 6%, so a good little run for them, up nearly a buck. On the year, it's kind of what you might expect given what we've seen out there with oil. kind of following that trajectory roughly a year ago, was trading $9 roughly. And then it kind of drifted lower to about almost six and a half bucks. That was back in August of last year. Then it kind of rallied again up to $9 and change in October, gave it up again down to $6 and change back in December. And ever since December 1st, it's kind of been on a mostly upward trajectory, which kind of does follow along with the broad energy market out there as well. Shot up to $18.77. That was the high on April 20th. So it's actually off its high. Then it gave some of that back, trading $15.90 about a week later. A couple weeks after that, got down to 14 and a third before rallying again today. Like I said, it's up almost a buck just today. So it's had a nice pop just in the last couple of sessions. Let's see what our Eye of Sauron found out there today, Mr. Uncle Mike. Are they buying into this rally? Or are they kind of drifting along with it? Or are they fading it? Let us find out. Looks like someone, Mr. Uncle Mike, is coming out and just decided to draw a pretty sizable line in the sand in good old Patterson UTI Energy Inc. coming in this morning and blasting away at 9,550 of the June 12 puts. So pretty much exactly $4 out of the money puts, listeners. They sold them for 22 cents. They actually got a couple of cents price improvement. They were 20 cent bid. They sold them for 22 cents, almost 10,000 times. It's not bad getting 2 cents 10,000 times. That's about a 79 vol. So these are pretty juicy, listeners, all things considered. The stock, I should point out, was about half a buck, exactly half a buck lower. It's 1553. It's 1603 right now. So yes, this one was, these puts are, if you're looking to double down and try to follow up on this trade, these puts are not going to be 20 cent bid anymore, listeners. The stock has moved. There are earnings, but they're not until July. So this is not an earnings play. Mr. Uncle Mike, this just seems like somebody taking advantage of a recent pop to say, you know what, I'm going to get myself some of this Patterson if it dips below the 12 strike. It was below 12 not too long ago. It was trading in a 10 handle back in early February. Obviously, once the invasion happened, it kicked it into a higher gear. So it has seen that level not too long ago, Uncle Mike. But it seems like someone writing a pretty massive line in the sand on the 12 strike in P10, sir. What say you?
I think that if they want it, that's fine, but good gosh, this is a lot of volatility. You said it was, what, a 79 implied volatility?
Yes, sir.
They have more lining on their stomach than I do, apparently. So typically what I like doing on stocks like this is that if I have a sentiment on them, I would probably, and the volatility is that high, I would probably buy a directional out-of-the-money butterfly of some sort. If he wants to own the stock and he's fine with that, then God bless him. But that's a lot of vol to be messing with, in my opinion.
He wants to buy all the stock down at the 12 strike, it seems like. So, yes, this one's been moving around quite a bit. We could see energy crater. I mean, it could happen. Crazier things have happened, and that would probably take P10 with it. It sounds like our friend here is not upset about picking up, close to a million shares of good old P10 here at the $12 level. What do you guys think about this trade? I know you guys like yourself a little bit of juicy puts. These are pretty juicy. Not quite as juicy as they were this morning when he sold them, but perhaps if the name retreats, you can maybe get a second tilt at the windmill. You guys intrigued about these? Hit us up. Let us know. Meanwhile, let's go out to a name we've been talking about a little bit. Remember, it was on the show about a month and change ago. Listen, we talked about someone coming in, and they were just, I think actually it might have been more than that. It might have been a couple of months. I think it was right around, or right immediately after the invasion back in late February, where we saw people were obviously spooked about a lot of financial names, exposure to Eastern Europe. In particular, Credit Suisse was one of them. That's our next name, by the way, listeners. Someone coming in and loading up on a ton of very, very near term. I think there were weekly puts. I think they were around the 9 handle. My memory serves me. I'll have to go look and check. Those, I remember, ended up not working out because they were very short duration. If they had waited a little bit longer, though, perhaps things may have worked out for them, because we're going back to Credit Suisse right now, listeners. And this is the name is trading $6.56 right now. So I do believe those juicy, juicy puts would have been all right if they had gotten a little bit more time on their hands. The saga, the sordid tale, that is Credit Suisse. A year ago, they were trading $10.50. And they kind of, unlike every other name in the market last year, they didn't really move aggressively. They kind of languished in that range for most of the year. They topped out in January at 10. They were still $10.50 on January 13th. So they really didn't do a whole heck of a lot last year. They kind of languished. I think they got as low as about 941 and as high as, looks like, about almost 11, 1098. I think they briefly hit 1119, actually, intraday, for closing at 1098. And that was kind of about it. And then, of course, all the madness happened, and they sold off from $10 exactly on February 8th. They hit 689 on March 7th. And then they rallied a bit again. They got up to about 8.25 on March 22nd before kind of giving up the ghost again down to where they are right now, back to. They actually got down last week to 620. I think intraday they actually hit 607. So they almost broke the six handle before rallying back to where they are right now, $6.50 roughly. Mr. Uncle Mike, it seems like someone maybe thinks this this drubbing of Credit Suisse, all this concern and hand-wringing over the European debt and credit exposure, perhaps a bit overdone, because someone scooped this morning 5,000 of the May 6 calls. They paid 55 cents, so they lifted the offer. That's about a 50 vol. So these are not cheap from a premium or a vol perspective. There's no earnings in this. The next earnings announcement is in July. So this is straight up, as it seems, Mr. Uncle Mike, somebody lifting the offer. And these are Mays. So this is a weekly. This is, again, someone, whoever this is, whoever these people are playing Credit Suisse, they love very, very short duration trades. And they're doing that again this week. What say you about these weekly six handle calls that are actually in the money right now? When did these go up? These went up when the stock was here. So they're buying an in-the-money call to begin with. Another strange choice. Mr. Uncle Mike, what say you, sir?
Well, good for them. I think that they looked at what they wanted to do, and they used options instead of stock. And they're probably at a point to, I mean, they may have over-levered themselves, who knows, but this is a case where they used options instead of stocks, and they're buying the dip, and the dip has helped them from where the dip was. So my hat's off to them, and just... I would recommend, if they are listeners to this show, which I know is not likely, but you never know, that they do start trimming some positions as they get higher and not you make full use of all of the contracts.
That is the case. I did manage to find these. These were actually, I think we talked about these maybe on our Options Oddities program as well. So these are, I found them. They were on January 21st. Looks like someone was blasting away at the 10 strike, but there also were some puts. I have to find those too. So those are. Those are eluding me at the moment, listeners. But if I keep digging, perhaps I could find where we talked about. See if I can find these puts for you, because they are kind of the polar opposite of what we're talking about right here. Here we go. This was on the show on March 10th, and someone was coming in to just load up, back up the truck. So the stock was lower back then. I remember thinking the stock was on the 9 head, but I was obviously thinking of those 10 calls that they were selling back in January. In March, they were buying puts on the 7 strike, the March 7 puts. The stock was $7.50 at the time, and they bought a ton. They bought 13,000 and then 10,000 and then 5,000. Total of 53,000 they bought at that time. They ended up not working out, as I recall. And they also did it in Deutsche Bank as well. Those were the 10.5 strike puts out there as well. So that was a crazy time back there on March 10th. And now we have someone betting the other way. What do you guys think about Credit Suisse? It's kind of been all over the place the last few months. You down with the put buyer from about a month or change ago, or you're down with the call buyer out here right now? Hit us up, let us know. So you go on into our final name, our final victim, our final celebutant, if you will, on the odd block today. This is Hello Group Inc. Ticker symbol MOMO, M-O-M-O. Obviously with a name like that. And a ticker like that. Yeah, they're coming at you out of China. Trading $5.08 right now. They're actually up a whopping 3 cents today. So not exactly an epic saga for today. On the year, a little bit more epic, though. A year ago, they were trading $14 exactly. So they've pretty much given up almost $9 on the year, listeners. They briefly flirted with, looks like, June 28th. They got up to $16.33. And then ever since then, it's been pretty much mostly downside on the screen, getting to, they got as low as 414 last week, listeners, before they got about $1 back since then. But it doesn't seem like the year has been good. Let's see if our Eye of Sauron wants to be good to them, though. Let's see, what did we find out here today in MOMO? I like that ticker, MOMO. Doesn't say what this name is outside of Hello Group and their Chinese leader in internet content and information. So there you go. Momo, they were, let's see, this morning we saw, it's like somebody really has an axe to grind on the $4.38 strike. So obviously, a bit of a corporate action out here, obviously working with some adjusted strikes. We noticed first 3,614 of those 438 puts going up for 30 cents on the bid. We also saw right before then another 2,000 for 30 cents and then 500 and so on and so forth. A total of 11,000 of these July $4.38 puts had gone up for prices at or around 30 cents by the time we kicked off the show. That's about a 77 vol. So going back to look at this chart, listeners, 438 and getting 30 cents for it, you're getting the stock at 408. That's pretty much the low for the year out there, actually a little, couple of cents below it. So I guess just purely looking at this chart, not looking at anything else with this stock, that level isn't the worst, but intriguing stuff nonetheless. Mr. Uncle Mike, what do you think about these Momo puts in Hello Group Inc., sir?
And definitely intriguing to me that there's the corporate action strike price. Usually in I've been listening to Unusual Activity for over 10 years now on this show, and normally it's like the 450 put or the 4 put or something like that, but on a put that there was a weird strike price because of corporate action, you don't see that very often. So that was probably the first thing that came into my brain, and God bless Momo.
Do you have FOMO for not trading Momo? Hit us up. Let us know, listeners. You going to trade these books as we keep on rolling? It is time to unleash Uncle Mike. It is time for the strategy block.
It's time to dispense options wit, wisdom, and education. It's time for the strategy block.
All right, everybody, welcome to the strategy block, a portion of the show where we unleash Uncle Mike. Before we do that, really quickly, I just went and looked up at OCC, which is what I recommend everyone does when you see weird strikes like this in a name. You go to the Options Clearing Corp website, you type in the ticker, and there will be a circular there explaining exactly what happened. In this case, Hello Group Inc., aka Momo, declared a special cash dividend of 62 cents on March 31st of this year. So as a result, remember we talked about this, if you listen to our Options Bootcamp show, there are certain rules, what will trigger a contract adjustment from a dividend perspective, what will not. Obviously, this did trigger to reduce the strike prices by 62 cents. Across the board, hence why we have $4.38 puts out there right now. So there you go, a little bit of education for you before Uncle Mike lays the mother load on you. Uncle Mike, what you got in store for them today, sir?
Oh, it's the mother load, all right. I want to expand on last week's strategy block on strike price selection for long puts, and now this week I want to talk about strike price selection for short puts. So let's say that you are looking to sell a put. And now might not be a bad time to consider it if you feel that volatility is high and that the market is low. It's something to, with which you can consider. So if you're in that camp, once again, if you're not in that camp, don't go in that camp just to be in that camp. You want to be in that camp because you believe in that camp. And I just made all that up just now. That's kind of crazy. Anyway, you have three choices when selling a put option. First one is an in-the-money put. Meaning that you're selling a put with a strike price above the price of the underlying. Remember, puts are the opposite of calls. So if XYZ stock is at 30 and you're selling the 32 put, that's an in-the-money put with which you're selling. Now, of the three, you're looking to be bullish neutral on the stock if you are in this camp. And so if you are bullish neutral, meaning you think the stock's going to go up a little bit, but I don't know if it's necessarily going to go up a ton. I just like to collect some premium because I really don't see this thing tanking. In that scenario, the most bullish choice of the three would be an in-the-money put because of the fact that you'll have a little bit of extrinsic, aka time value, in the put most likely, and you'll get to participate on the upside. Now, the next way with which you can go when selling a put, you can sell an at-the-money put. XYZ stocks at 25, you sell the 25 put. Now, the advantage of that is that's where you're going to get the most juice, the most at-the-money time decay. So in other words, if God were to tell me that a stock's going to be perfectly still and never move, once again, if God were to tell me, no, God does not tell me where stocks are going to go. It'd be really cool if he did, but if you were to tell me that of these three choices, the antimony put would be the most profitable because that's where you're going to have the most time decay in place. You'll have a little bit less benefit for the stock going higher with the antimony put, and you'll have a little bit more than an out of the money, which we'll talk about in a little bit. Where you're looking to profit when selling an at-the-money put is you believe the stock is the most neutral of these three choices. And finally, an out-of-the-money put. An out-of-the-money put means the strike price is below the price of the underlying. So if XYZ stock is at 43 and you sell the 40 put, then you are selling an out-of-the-money put. A lot of times people do that. The scenario that comes up a lot of times is that people will look at a stock and say, you know what, I think premium is pretty high right now, or implied volatility is pretty high right now, so you can get some pretty good premium. And I wouldn't mind owning this stock if it went down a little bit. And so a lot of times when people have that sentiment, they sell an out-of-the-money put. And what that does is if the stock stays the same, well, okay, no harm, no foul. You get to collect on the put that, on the money that you took in from the short put. And then you can do it again the next month or the next season or whatever way you're doing it. And let's say that the stock does go down. Well, you wanted to own it at that level anyway, if it were to go down. By selling a put, you get paid to do something that you wanted to do anyway. Now, of course, the disadvantage to that is if the stock goes down and then right back up and then you don't get assigned, that would be an area with which just a limit order would be better if you're trying to not have the risk of not being filled. And then the other thing with which to think about when comparing a limit order to an out-of-the-money put is that the out-of-the-money put actually pays you to get in if it's in and you're assigned at expiration. So when doing this, it's very important that you have a really good understanding of how strike prices work. And if you want more information on strike price selection for selling puts, I should have it up on my YouTube video by later today, hopefully tomorrow at the latest. Check out St. Charles Wealth Management on YouTube.
All right. And as we keep on rolling, it is time to get a real quick mail block.
It's time to take your seat on the All-Star panel as we read your emails, tweets, Facebook messages, website comments, and much more. It's time for the mail block.
Welcome to the mail block, the portion of the show where you guys get to dictate what we talk about. Uncle Mike, this is kind of funny, actually, because this came in before you did your strategy block in our live chat. We had Frank1209 listening live saying, is Uncle Mike still selling put spreads now? And if so, how far out of the money in SPY, of course? Uncle Mike, it's like he envisioned your strategy block that was to come, sir.
He must have. And to answer your question, yes, I am. And I can't give exact strike prices, but how far out of the money? Let's just say very. Right now, the market's negative on the year. And when the market's negative on the year, I kind of pull in the horns. If the market's not strong enough to be positive on the year in May, then that means it's not a strong market to me. And so I've rolled down my put spreads. They're far out of the money and they're a couple months out and they're very boring. So I'm just doing that. And I just have the simple rule with this. Rule number one, do everything you can to not let them go in the money. You can never guarantee that, of course, but I really try that. And then rule number two, don't forget rule number one. And if you follow those rules, you usually come out okay in the end, although it can be a stressful ride at times, not going to lie.
You know, what was an interesting ride over the past week, listeners, was our question of the week, as suggested by the once future and present Dr. Vix. He wanted to know, so many of you in cash look into BTFD, so buy the friendly dip, let's just say, in the markets. How low does it have to go before you pull the trigger? We gave you four choices around here, which is ironically exactly where we are again this week. This is where we posted it last week, right around 4,000 in the S&P, or the next support, which is somewhere around 3,700, or the pre-pandemic level, which was 3,375. Or your full-on lookout below mode, which is below 3,000. Mr. Uncle Mike, as all the votes were tabulated at the end of the week, sir, it was the next support around 3,700 level that seemed to draw the lion's share of your attraction, almost 37%, about 36.8% choosing that. Number two, the pre-pandemic level, 33.75 at about 29.1%. Then 22.2% said, you're hanging out right around here, so you're happy right here, right around 4,000. And 12% saying, you're in lookout below mode. You're not buying back in until it hits below 3,000. Mr. Uncle Mike, what are your thoughts on those levels? Do they surprise you? And anything resonating to you from those numbers, sir?
No, they don't. And the 3,700 level, that's about the level with which we ended 2020. And so I think that's a pretty good level. What's holding us up right now from a technical standpoint or just a non-fundamental standpoint is the 4,000 mark. I think 4,000 is kind of a tough nut to crack and stay below it. It wouldn't surprise me if we had the 4,000 as a magnet number. I remember actually on this show almost every day, the S&P just kind of just really stuck to 2,000 for quite a while, if you look at a chart. Maybe right now 4,000 might be the new 2,000. So we'll see.
All right. And our question of the week this week, listeners, is let's see where, here we go. Yes. You know, everyone's in cash looking for safe havens in these wild markets. Which non-equity asset class is looking the most attractive to you right now? If you don't see your choice, of course, as always, you can reply or DM with your suggestion, and gave you four choices. Fixed income, so the traditional choice. Then we have metals, energy, crypto. That's a contentious one for a lot of you these days. And of course, a lot of you writing in with your others already. Mr. Uncle Mike, sir, what is your vote amongst those? And what do you think our audience is voting for, sir?
Well, if I wasn't already in fixed income in a lot of ways, I'd probably get in a little bit more of it right now. I think that with the time that we've had for bonds to digest the Fed, bonds have gotten beat up kind of bad this year. And so I think that with fixed income where it is, I would like that one at this stage because it is lower and actually is paying a little bit of an interest rate right now. So you do have that. In terms of energy and crypto, I don't know if I would necessarily view those as a safer area. So I'll vote fixed income, and I'll say the audience is doing the same thing.
The audience is saying pshaw to your fixed income choice, sir. They are all about energy right now. 50% exactly choosing energy right now, Uncle Mike. Tied for number two.
About interesting.
19% each almost for metals and crypto. And then bringing up the rear, Uncle Mike, is your suggestion of fixed. They want nothing to do with bonds right now, sir. They think they do not. They are all about the energy. Hard to blame you. I mean, energy is rocking right now. So, yes, past is prologue. You might be convinced that there's more to come. We shall see. You know, there is more to come with the show. It is time for our final segment. It is time to go around the block.
It's time to tell you what we'll be watching on our trading screens until the next episode. It's time for Around the Block.
All right, everybody. Welcome to Around the Block, the portion of the show where we tell you what we're keeping an eye on for the rest of this week. Mr. Uncle Mike, sir, what is on your radars? We're all watching these strike levels and supports and resistances in the S&P, sir.
Definitely 4,000. That's something that Fitch I'm watching. And then silver's making a run to the 20 level again, so watching that level as well. And then just the 3% on the 10-year note, that's something else with which I'm watching. And every headline imaginable.
Uncle Mike is watching every headline imaginable. He's that guy in the room with 50 screens and his eyes bolted to all of them, glued open like in Clockwork Orange. All right, listeners, that music means we are done for the option block. But you know what? We're not done for our content today, not by a long shot. We'll be joined a little bit later today by Edul Patel, the CEO of Mudrex. He'll be in the hot seat on the crypto rundown a little bit later today. What is Mudrex? It is an all-in-one crypto investment platform. So interesting stuff. They have curated solutions for longer-term type trading, which is interesting. You don't hear about long-term too often in crypto. It's a lot about bam, 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 right now, immediate stuff. So intriguing stuff. We'll have that. And of course, all the action, the volatility, the skew, and a whole bunch more coming up in a little bit on the Crypto Rundown. But before we go, Mr. Uncle Mike, if folks are intrigued, they want to check out what you have cooking, maybe talk to you about put strike selection in a little bit more detail, where should they go? What should they do?
Places. You can check out my YouTube channel. Just type in St. Charles Wealth Management. Follow me on Twitter at Mike Tusaw. That's where I'll be releasing at Mike T-O-S-A-W. That's where I'll be releasing the link to the short put YouTube video a little bit later today, hopefully by tomorrow at the latest, but likely today. And then if you are looking for a financial advisor who actually sells them some puts, assuming it's appropriate for the client, feel free to check out my website, stcharleswealth.com.
stcharleswealth.com is the place to go. And of course, they weren't here today, but they're in town, so we'll give them a plug anyway. Optionpit.com is the place to go. Maybe you want to check out, they might still have some seats left for their Chi-Town extravaganza. Check it out. Optionpit.com is the place to go. We got to get on out of here. For all of our live listeners, we'll be back in a little bit with Crypto Rundown. All you folks on demand, just got to wait until it hits the network. Hit next, and hopefully it'll be there for you. And then, of course, back again tomorrow. Pro folks, you guys get a lot of content coming at you tomorrow. You get, of course, a pro Q&A with the one and only Scott Nations. You get a double dose of live Options Bootcamp episodes tomorrow as well. Wednesday, you're getting your usual taste of OPR and Education Wednesday. And then back again on Thursday, another episode of the Option Block. Stay safe out there, everybody.
You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at Twitter.com/options, StockTwits.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or via questions at TheOptionsInsider.com.